Excellent. Thank you very much for this introduction. And I think I have to press here. That was the wrong one. It's coming. Excellent. First of all, I have an indecent question. Who is above 35 years old? Please lift your hand. Above 35? One person? Two? Who else? Somebody else. Come on. 35-ish? Excellent. So normally at my lectures, a lot of hands go up above 35, and then I have the bad news for that person, because when you live in Russia and you're above 35, you're officially old. It's a little bit different in America. You're officially old when you're 40 years old, because that actually marks a point where you have surpassed 50% of your life expectancy. And with 50%, it's before it's young and it's old, and this is why I'm interested in aging. But first of all, just very briefly, I want to just tell you who else I am. So I'm an architect in New York, and we also started Architizer, which is a social networking site. The architectural firm is called Hollwitz Kushner, and what we do actually architecture on all scales. The smallest projects we're doing, it's 9 feet by 9 feet by 9 feet, and the biggest ones are big towers in New Jersey. So we're doing product design with branding work. We won the Young Architects Program for the Museum of Modern Art PS1 with our project Wendy. We recently designed the Pines Pavilion on Fire Island, which is a social hub. We're doing a new hotel in Williamsburg. And we're doing right now our largest project, which is 1,800 apartments in New Jersey. But the real passion and the much bigger project is called New Aging. Because I believe that we actually have to start a revolution. We have to start a revolution not against a regime, we have to start a revolution against ourselves. Because we all believe, at least in Western society, that this wonderful moment where we retire and we play golf and we're happy ever after. But the truth is that there's a moment in life where we end in places where we do not want to be. Because we don't want to be at a place where we are alone. We don't want to be in a place where we depend on others. And we do not want to be in a place where we are just being stored away from society. But that is actually reality. And this is why me, as an architect, I'm asking us, as a profession, why do we, especially in America, we're designing 17,000 nursing homes. And there are 17,000 reasons not to move into any one of them. We're also designing buildings that become hazardous and horrible to live in when we're getting older. And even worse, we're actually designing parts of the city that are trapping us and make us immobile and exclude us from society. We all are aging. There's absolutely nothing mysterious about it. Look, it's just happening to us right now. We're just aging every minute, and we know what's coming in our own future if we consider and we are realistic about our future. For example, when you look at this curve here, you see 100 people are being born, and in 100 years, 100 people will die. It's a fact. There's nothing that we can avoid. And in this kind of process, you see the percentage of people who cannot drive a car anymore. And you see when you're actually 70, already 50% of us lost the possibility to use a car. We cannot depend on a car when we're aging. The same thing is with difficulties in tasks. Again, we see these numbers here. people have more and more problems with bathing, with dressing, with walking, with shopping. All of these kind of things are happening to us. But we're living in denial and we pretend it's not happening until it happens and we are surprised. So we have to take this into account. And then what happens, and this is a statistics from America, is that how we live not alone, and then we live in a nursing home, and up to 30% of people live in a nursing home at a given time. And actually the fact is that 1/3 of all Americans will live in a nursing home for a period of time. To change that, we actually look back to Architizer and we try to find a group of architects where we together can try to make a difference, because we believe that actually architecture is at the centerpiece of challenges with aging and our society. We looked for architectural firms that have never done anything with age-related architecture, so no nursing home, no retirement community. And we looked for architectural firms that are progressive and very collaborative. So the firms that we found were very multifold, and they're starting from Dillo Scofidio Renfro, who designed the High Line in New York, to Sada Vuga, who's a beautiful firm in Slovenia, to L2, which is a young firm from Israel, to Lowtech, which is doing, for example, here the Puma store from New York, Jürgen Meyer, the architect from Berlin, Joel Sander, another residential architect from New York, Madeline Ginz from New York, Surface Design from San Francisco, and ourselves, HWCan. So we got together and we created workshops to consider, to reconsider aging and architecture. And the first thing what we found was that we have to deal with the elderly, this kind of ambiguous group of older people. But we learned immediately that these kind of people, the elderly, actually don't exist. That is a group that we declare that is kind of has a common lifestyle, but it's not true, because these people are just old people. And even more so, they're just people. They're you and me in a few years from now. With that in mind, we started to rethink our approach, and we really put into our promise that we want to create an environment where people can live the life you want, the people can live the life they want. And it has to be based on individuality. We all are different, not just today, also in our future. We want to be self-determined, we want to make our decisions, and we don't want other people to make decisions for us. It needs to be meaningful. It cannot happen that we become silly and play bingo at a later stage in our lives and that's all what we do. There needs to be something that has relevance and meaning. And it needs to be connected to the community in our society, with a very kind of clear idea of social exchange and social responsibility, but also the idea of gradual help. And here you see this image of when you have two workout partners. You cannot replace activities just to help people. You have to help them just as much you need to, so that they can still do as much as possible themselves to have the maximum effect. And then, of course, safety and security. All of this together kind of came up into a retirement community that we designed, where we took away the retirement and we created an empowerment community. But the question is how? And it's actually much easier than you think, because it all comes down to common sense. You have to take regular life as it is today, your life, and you just have to take into account physical and social deficits and exchange the elements that don't work at a given time. So what we created is a community that is called Boom, and it's a speculative project in Palm Springs, in the heart of the city, where it was essential that it was located in the middle of the urban fabric. And these 10 architects, from Jürgen Meyer to Sada Vuga and everyone together, was asked to come up with a bold own new vision, which we combined into one bold community. Because it is important that we cannot design with one ideology for all of us. We actually have to design individually with varies with lifestyles that people want to appreciate and find the place they feel fit in the best. So it becomes basically lifestyle living with all the kind of different areas. You see here, this is the community and a floor plan with all the individual architecture in itself. So Rudin Donner used, for example, like a very dense kind of Greek urbanism for his portion of the site. Lotek created a kind of suburban loft that became part of the community. Sada Vuga with ultimative transparency and built around kind of communities. To Jürgen Meyer, who created this kind of sculptural three-dimensional houses, which combined actually multiple apartments within one building to create a new idea of neighborhood with your neighbor, because you live in the same building with views connecting to each other. And then our kind of our scheme combined actually 22 apartments with kind of a more collective space in the center and also sports activities within. And when we think about the apartments, we have to totally rethink the way how we organize them. Because right now what we do, we create hierarchical apartments where we have a master bedroom and we have a smaller bedroom for the children. But at the moment when we're getting older, our needs and necessities are different. And just think about when one of the partners potentially passes away, what do you do with the remaining space? And the new kind of living environments and living structures that can make all the difference. So here, for example, we created a design where we have just master bedrooms, which are unhierarchical, and you also have a new sense of privacy that you can actually enter the bedrooms without going through the living room. So that there's all choice, so that you can actually have a new apartment design that allows that friends live together and help each other, and you go actually beyond the idea of family structures, which are clearly outdated in today's time and have proven to be dysfunctional. And here you see from party and play in the early times, it turns into also the provision of turning your apartment into a healthcare environment when needed over time. And all of that is combined into this idea of stealth care. We need care, we need help at a given time, but we want to make sure that it doesn't become obvious, and with that becomes also part of a discrimination. So it needs to be subtle, and it needs to be just part of the way of life given by services. And then think about the bathroom. There are amazing, interesting relationships between architecture and medical responsibility. So there's, for example, a study that has shown that people get Alzheimer's because they don't drink enough. So not drinking enough triggers a disease. In another study, some people found out that older people don't drink anymore because they're afraid of using the bathroom, because it's really hard to lift yourself off from the toilets. So basically, when you misdesign a bathroom for the older people, you are actually responsible for Alzheimer's cases and their disease. So these kind of responsibilities, just to put that little handle here on the side where older person can lift himself up, will make all the difference, and you change the way how people can live in their own future. So this is universal design, and that is something we have to take into account, not just into the designs for older people, into all designs, so that it is possible to become generationless. And then added conveniences, we all enjoy services that come to us, and they can come in many kind of different fashions. And one of them is, of course, people helping each other. But then also, finally, technology with Android and iPhones, which become actually support systems for us as more and more we can relate to them through Siri, through apps, and even like hearing devices, for example, can be already replaced with a much hipper product, so that the technology now does not be built into the architecture anymore, but we can program it to compensate for some of these challenges. And then essential is that we actually bring the city to the people, or the people to the city. Since we designed a retirement community, which was turned into the empowerment community, all functions of a city are included, including the community kind of component. And it was essential for us that actually Jürgen Meyer was able to design the most sculptural and most interesting architecture. Because what we want to do is we want to fight age discrimination through the excellence in design. I believe our responsibility is to build the best and the most beautiful and the most interesting architecture for the aging community. Because with that, we can actually also counter the perception of getting older and inspire people to actually embrace it and come to terms with it. Of course, also the public space is essential to really make work for all ages. And we need to be ready for visitors, because one of the big challenges is social context. And with hotels and bed and breakfast, we can create the kind of environment where people can come visit and it's actually fun and not an obligation. And then open for business. We have to stop to think about retirement as a goal. We actually have to eliminate this idea and work for the rest of our lives. If you may want to retire because you hate your job, change your job and still do work. Because it's essential for the validation in our society to be part of it and to be productive and to also have a sense of accomplishment. So whatever we do in retirement communities, we have to bring in business centers, business environments, and infrastructures so that that architecture is here to support all of these kind of functions. And then there's intergenerational intersection, which is this beauty of the contract between our generations, where older can help younger, middle age can help middle age. So and there are beautiful relationships between the babies being taken care of older people. When you're getting a little bit older, maybe you can get some knowledge and you can learn from each other. And later on, there can be mentorship programs and vice versa. There's social contact and validation and also help for the older generation. So to trigger that, it's essential. And it, of course, we as architects here, a design from Madeleine Ginz can support all of this. And then the real outdoor to really embed it into a beautiful setting. And a nursing home. At some point, we may need that little bit of extra help because we do get sick and we have to have support. And this is our design, and we call it the most dangerous nursing home on the planet. Because it's dangerous, because it's about risk-taking, but it's also the form. It's generated by an idea of sustainability, where it actually becomes a heat chimney, but it's also a climbing wall. So when you're older and you're in a wheelchair, you suddenly see younger people just climbing by, and that makes all the difference, that makes your day, and it makes you not feel like being stored away for the rest of your life. So all of this comes together in this project that is BOOM Palm Springs. And in our experience, we wanted to go beyond just one development that we will establish in California. And we tested these same ideas in a project for BOOM also in Spain. In Spain, we had different kinds of challenges, and we wanted to actually test an idea where it was not so sculptural and individual as we had designed it before. And you see that this is a master plan where we pixeled a whole kind of urban landscape into the landscape so that every one of the buildings always has a maximum of greenery and freedom around. But also the beauty is when you think about the checkerboard is that now you don't have just two neighbors, you have four neighbors, and you always have a distance in between, so that you feel comfortable to be, you have proximity and liberty. Embedded in this kind of landscape, this kind of relationship became essential for us to exercise a new idea of suburban living, which really presents this idea of micro houses, which has the minimum sizes of buildings, and maximum of landscape around. And how this kind of relate, you see also that we commissioned different architects again to come together, where the beauty again is that we can exercise new ideas in architecture and they can be triggered by the new considerations on aging. And these were just simple sketches that came together from some of our colleagues that we invited to participate in this project. But it's really this idea again about fighting age discrimination through the excellence in design, and that can start on an urban scale or an individual scale and really accumulate on any kind of directions or levels what we design as architects. And this is one of my favorite prototypes. This is actually a apartment building with studio apartments on top of each other. And the idea is that there are shared community spaces with individual apartments so that everyone has his own own way of life, and you as a group together can curate basically the public space within the apartment building itself. All of this brought us to one step further, where we believe that you can design this kind of environments in horizontal or vertical fashion. And we had this amazing opportunity last year where we created a project that is called Max, which is an initiative from the Bloomberg administration, which is the mayor of New York. The mayor of New York wanted to create micro unit housing in the city because New York is so expensive, and I believe it's the same here in Moscow, that actually people cannot afford anymore to live in the city center. And Mayor Bloomberg looked into especially housing for younger people. But as soon as we started to work on this project, we realized it's going to be actually perfect for our older people. So what we did was we used a reference in car design where actually this new small is the new big. When you look at the mini car, it's really tiny, it's high design, and it's very desirable to live in. But Mini also does not just design the car, it also designs an environment around the car and also designs a lifestyle. So we looked into how can we just go beyond the programmatic requirements of small apartments with the maximization of lifestyle that we can incorporate as architects. The project is called Max, where you basically see the principle of hyperdense housing on the lower portions and very sculptural attributes on the top floor, which becomes the place for the building community to aggregate and get together with. This project, we were finalists with three people left for the competition, which was invited in New York last year. So what we did was we researched the average size of a home in America, which is 260 square meters of space. The average apartment in New York, it's just half, so it's 130 square meters. An average studio in New York is 45 square meters, and Max is just 25 square meters. That is as big as this kind of stage area here. It's really tiny. But what we did as compensation, it's almost what we did at Boom, where we actually filled up the rest of the building with communal collective spaces that is there for everyone to enjoy. And then what we did was we took the typical tower topology where all the base is where you have your programs and you have the penthouse where the rich people live, and we turned the building around and we actually put all the social programs and all the amenities to the roof, to the place where everyone wants to be. And that is the hat, the symbol of community and the symbol of society, where people aggregate and come together with the hidden idea behind it to restart the social engine between the people living in these micro studios. And the social engine can be calibrated and programmed with any kind of things what we believe that is important to activate the lifestyle, from communal kitchen to gyms to all kind of things that you can bring in any kind of fashion. And you still see here, it was originally designed for younger generations, but we realized it's actually really perfect for an aging society, because at that point you want to still live alone, but you also need the community around you, and the social hat is perfect for that. So with this set, it's actually from a traditional home where people live together with your kitchen and your living room to a typical apartment where you have no shared facilities, to a hybrid where it's almost like a home now for 55 different units, a home for 55 different people coming together. To design the floor plans, it's very challenging because it's really micro, it's tiny. And we had to put a lot of attention into making it also handicapped accessible, so that we have universal design in the bedrooms and into bathrooms. But then also flexibility, where actually a room, which is like a studio, can turn into a workspace and a social space, and can also turn into a bedroom. So with kind of just flexibilities, how we can unfold the furniture as built-in elements which can react to all these different kind of needs and necessities. Architecturally, to be able to build actually a building like this in New York economically, we looked into prefabrication. I don't know how common that is in Russia. In America, it's not. But there's a wonderful possibility to actually have these modular systems. You can just stack it on top of each other. And we had to comply to zoning laws in New York, which are very strict. But then the social hat really gave us the possibility to react to the overall envelope that was available to us. And the ground floor became the interface towards our neighbors, where it becomes kind of a hip club where people get together, not just from the building, so that the city can actually meet with the residents themselves. So this is Max, which is super efficient and visionary for an aging society with its social heart at the top. And all of these ideas can also become bigger from a scale of a house into the scale of a city itself. And I had the opportunity to work with the Bauhaus Foundation in Dessau in Germany on that idea on a city scale. And I just show you a few kind of slides of this idea of the metropolis, which actually then we kick out the metro and we turn it into Geropolis, the city of the elders. Geropolis is equal, what I mentioned before, diverse in its urban context. We have to take into account what I said before, that it's not about the elderly, it's about older people with all the individual lifestyle wants and desires. So with that said, we have to analyze the city about where people live with all the different kind of lifestyles and take these variations into account. Here in Geropolis, we found out the inner city areas, then there are the big kind of more neutral blocks and also suburban kind of single home areas. And we found these different kind of lifestyle groups in these neighborhoods, from the modern performer to the traditionalist to the consumer materialist. These are all terms which are being generated by the advertisement industry, but they have really figured out what people, what the income brackets are, what kind of products they purchase, how they live, and all of these kind of details. And when we use them and we analyze them and we translate them into architecture, we can come up with many different solutions which are not geared towards one kind of overall strategy. It becomes super individual and targeted towards the needs of these individual lifestyle groups. So just flipping through here, for example, for the rich, we created the Experience Campus with the benefit that we can invite younger people to come and be educated, but also older people and affluent people do have networks that were very valuable in terms of mentorship programs that we can translate into meeting points where they can support the younger groups. Or the village in the city, these neutral big blocks, and I have seen many of them, of course, also here in Moscow, where we break them open and make them more social and more open and more inviting, but maybe also comply to some of the traditional wants and desires that is embedded in the individual lifestyles of people. Or hotel urbanism. This is in the inner city blocks, which is actually where I would like to live. I want to have my apartment, but more communal infrastructure and hotel services embedded. And in this case, we found courtyards that were available where we could plug in these kind of programs. Or the liberal landscape, big road areas, closing them for traffic and bringing in all kind of social and communal activities. And this is, especially in Germany, you have this group of very active older groups of people where there's still no space for them to really exercise their kind of activities. And here it's translated into kind of also icons that would inspire people to come and join. Or in suburbia, where everything is built out and the only spaces left is the road that can become available. All of these, of course, are just provocations. These are no real kind of architectural propositions. But for us at the Bauhaus was important to actually go the extra step and beyond and actually inspire people and to see things different around them without just seeing the typical architectural solutions. Including, for example, here we have Magic Mountain. There's a very interesting relationship between jobs and retirement in Germany. Germany needs people, has to maintain jobs in the country. And when three older people migrate and live in Spain, you actually lose one job. So we looked into how can we design something attractive and different and exotic so that it can compete with places like Spain and Italy, that people would stay in Berlin and live there. All of these ideas you saw have been accumulated over the last 5 years, and I have run a lot of design studios and research studios at the University of Pennsylvania. And I realized in this whole process that we as architects are really at the center of these changes that have been triggered. And it's actually essential, especially when we're young, to take charge and make the difference, because all of us here are going to be active architects for many more years. And this is the only chance how we can actually manifest this kind of changes. But we also need really the support of the society to let us as architects do the work we need to do. That's why I started this idea of new aging and wrote a book that is very, 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 very urgent, which is a book that is based not on architecture, it's actually just based on changing people's mind about their own future selves. And it starts with a chapter that you have to declare yourself old early. You guys are too young, but all of us who had the hand up above 35, it's a time to say, you're not young, you're old, take it serious, get over it. We have to do it sooner than later. We should not wait to the moment where we are unable to live the life that we are used to and we're forced to change, to move, to give up our car. Just do it earlier. Get rid of your car at the moment you can still drive so that you can accommodate and accustom yourself to a new way of life and make these right decisions. Extend your family. Don't trust just that your kids will help you in your own future. Actually, just be social and always consider also friends as part of your family, because that is a network that will be essential for you to have a happy life. Never retire, by all means. If you don't like your job, get rid of your job, find a new one. if you have to retire, start volunteering. It's essential that we stay in the network of the society with all of the validations of ourselves and our peers around us. Stay fit and eat well. I think that's very common sense. And even just walking up the stairs and not taking the elevator makes all the difference. And adding services and conveniences is something that we should not just do because we need to. We should do it actually also because we want to. And many of these actually services and conveniences we can recreate also by actually depending on some of our friends. And when we expect them to receive, we should also allow ourselves to give. And the last point is never ever enter a nursing home except when you have to visit a friend who did not know how to new age. Because nursing homes, it's the guarantee that we will pass away in less than 2 years, and it's the place that is the least supportive for aging. It is actually just the beginning of the end. So with that said, I'm open now for a conversation where architecture turns into lifestyle and where I believe that we have to start this revolution together. And again, it's not a revolution against anything else than against ourselves, because first of all, we have to change our minds, how we perceive ourselves in our future aging, and how we actually look into the idea of an older society. Thank you. And now questions. And I have a translator if you want to speak Russian. Otherwise, I'm going to ask questions.
Извините, где можно взять информацию по вашим проектам, по каким-то архитектурным чертежам и дизайнерским решениям?
You can get information when I give you my business card. Or also our website hwken.com. There's a lot of information. Yeah. But I give you my card.
Thank you.
More questions?
Thank you very much for your lecture and for beautiful pictures. I would like to ask one thing. You have been saying that to be successful, your projects need to have support from society. Of course, it's normal and it's logical. But it's also important to have support from municipal government, for example. Could you give some examples of these successful collaboration you have already had as a company during buildings, during building these projects and doing these projects? Thanks.
Yeah, so there's, let's say in our case, since these projects are happening in America, there's something that people have to take care for themselves. And actually the boom projects are being financed by a private developer who knows that he actually will make money and make a profit on these projects. When we go beyond that, and there's also, I'm part of this advisory group for mayors of America, where actually the more ideological kind of change and the kind of conversation is happening right now. And it's really fascinating when I'm in a room, which is the opposite like this room, where everyone has actually gray hair, and I talk about that I'm old, and everyone looks at me, it's like denial that they're old themselves. But they're the decision makers about all of these municipality kind of programs, but they have no awareness that they're already on route for, let's say, an older lifestyle, which they should support themselves. It's still shocking to me. And I have given many kind of lectures and conversations now to this kind of group, and it's a slow change. But what is most interesting about it is that aging can become very personal. Because we all have a father or mother or grandfather and grandmother, and they live mostly in conditions that we hope we never will be in ourselves. And that is a good entry. And I think the best strategy is make it personal and find their grandfathers and make them believe that something can be different. More questions?
А вот какой-то проект, который самый старый, сколько у него стаж воплотился в жизни, вот сколько он уже существует? Есть ли какие-то первые выводы, какие-то опыты? Может быть, у вас есть там ошибки? Это вот как бы первая часть вопроса. А вторая часть вопроса, вы учитывали, скажем так, исследования психологов по поводу процесса старения? Потому что некоторые вещи, вот, которые я видел на экране, они нетипичные, это старики этого не поймут или не примут, как-то вот такие вопросы. То есть психологи вас консультируют? Все.
Yeah, so I think when you do projects, there are always mistakes, and there's also a lot of learning ourselves. And I think at the very beginning we wanted to design environments for people who are 65. Then we learned that we should design for people who are 55 and then 40. And now I actually believe we have to design for everyone because there's an amazing power about combining generations together that can help each other, and it makes it actually better for everyone. So I think that was a big mistake at the very beginning, which we had to review and revise. Another one is also aging services, like nursing homes. There is a need and necessity for some infrastructure that helps older people when there are dementia or any kind of real medical emergencies. And that now needs to be much better integrated in these kind of communities. And in our latest thinking, they're actually at the center. Because when you're in a hospital, it's better when you're actually very easily accessible, so that you're still part of the community. So that's one of them. And sorry, what was the second part of the question? You have to repeat. Yes, now I got it. Cool. Psychologist.
И на первый не ответили. То есть вы не сказали конкретно, сколько лет, вот, например, какому-то проекту, который уже есть. Про ошибки я поняла, что они у вас были. С этим все ясно. Вот. А вторая часть вопроса касалась по поводу консультации психологов. То есть психологи принимали участие в разработке этих проектов? Именно психологи, профессионально, которые занимаются проблемой старения.
Got it. Yeah, so also all of these projects we're doing are still ongoing. So they're not finished in terms of build. So we still have to prove how they work out when they're all done. And in terms of psychologists, I think it's absolutely essential to have them involved. We do have some advisors. But there's also a very interesting misperception. What we as architects always have is that the elderly, the older people, think very differently or want to live very differently than we do. There are gradual changes, for example, the perception of noise, aesthetic, lighting, and so on. But when I hear one more time in my life that somebody says, like, oh, we have to design a community garden for the elderly, then I'm going to freak out, because the problem is that we believe, oh, gardening going to be great for this kind of older people, but if you allow that older people can still do all the things that they want to do, they will not end up in a garden. They will go to a theater, they're going to go to a cinema, they're going to go out dancing. It is just about us designing the environments that includes everyone and not excludes older people. More questions? One more. Yes. Hold on.
What do your parents think about your ideas about aging and about
Hold on, say it again.
and about your projects?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's actually like one term I haven't used yet. We always try to find a new term for old people. And at the Bauhaus, we started to call old people pioneers. Because old people come to a point in life where nobody alive has ever been before. Death. And when I told my father that he is a pioneer, he was beyond excited. And he actually wanted to move into Magic Mountain, one of our projects. So I guess my family is embracing it. He's also happy that I'm also old now, so he feels more integrated. Cool, I think no more questions. So if anyone has a more, there's one more over there. Yeah.
Добрый вечер. А сколько будет стоить, насколько это будет доступно жилье для тех же пожилых людей? И это будет оплачиваться либо государством, либо из карманов детей, внуков и так далее. То есть насколько доступно данный вид жилья будет? Спасибо.
Yeah, that's actually always a tricky part in architecture. So the first project you saw, the Palm Springs one, it's very expensive, and that is maybe one of the mistakes we made and what we learned. So the second generation of projects, the one in Spain, we already looked into the economy of architecture and we reduced the cost quite drastically per unit. But then the most cost-effective one is actually Max. The building, it can beat actually every price in Manhattan by half. But it's really also much more cost-effective because of its size. But this is just architecture, so that is basically just the building. The additional costs are coming, of course, from services that normally it's what the government has to provide in some countries. In some other countries, like also in the US, it hardly does it. And then you have to pay for them extra. And the whole idea of some of the things what I described is that we reignite a social engine so that actually people can help each other and actually provide services to each other in a very informal way, which is satisfying for both of them. The one who gets service, the other one who is being helped. So for example, today we talked about it already, like the cost, for example, to drive from here to the airport for me with a taxi going to be maybe $50 that are 3,000 ruble or something. But if my friend is driving me, it's going to be just $5. So the difference is that if you include a corporation, a service that is professionally given, it's always much more expensive because it is about all the kind of value system that is included. So we can actually reduce the cost drastically if we reignite the social engine between people to help each other, but to also make it not an obligation, to actually make it fun or just part of way of life. And that is at least, it's an ambition that is all built into these communities. And obviously it all varies from country and from financial, let's say, proposition if the government is jumping in.
Добрый вечер, Матиас. Спасибо за лекцию, за идеи, за разъяснение о взрослых людях. Каждую неделю захожу на Architizer. И следующий вопрос. Сколько вам лет и во сколько вы задумались над таким вопросом, как взрослые, ну, как бы престарелые люди, и что вас сподвигло на такую, как бы, на такие действия?
Yes, so I have to admit my age. So I'm 42. In European standards, I'm officially old since 2 years. And it really started that I became interested in this when I was 38 or 37, where I actually saw all the statistics about aging and seeing that my life expectancy is 78. So basically halfway through, I realized that it becomes important now to think about the second part of my life. But then on top of it, I also have the wonderful experience of having lived in a home with my family and my grandmother, who passed away living in the house. And even that was very hard to see her die, it gave me the most amazing let's say, relationship to life, that I was able to experience that it will end at some point, and it can end in dignity, and it did for her. And I see it all over the world that it doesn't happen so easily. And especially in America, these nursing homes, people are stored away, they're just passing away without anyone realizing. And we as architects really have it in our hands and in our responsibility. And the beauty is, what I believe is, if, and I don't know how your experience is, but our work very often is geared by efficiency and by developers, and we are being forced to do things the way how it's being done for years and years and years. And by us now introducing the ideas of aging, we introduce a new market to the developers, and we can actually request innovations and to make a difference. So with that, it becomes actually a unique value proposition. It helps us very well in business, and we can refresh architecture and design differently. So altogether, so far it makes a lot of sense for us to actually make a positive impact to society, but it also helps business.
Спасибо. Второй вопрос. Даже предложение, может быть, вам стоит идеи брать не только из зданий для молодежи, но и из идеи для детских садов, потому что можно провести грань, как бы младенец и совсем уже взрослый человек, уже старый человек. То есть те же, в принципе, самые функции и та же самая уровень безопасности. То есть как бы это предложение. А вопрос, где можно купить вашу книгу, которую вы показали в конце лекции?
You're absolutely right. It's actually when we started to design for the 65-year-olds and 55 years and then 40-year-old, we realized it's actually there are so many advantages of when we design for older people, taking every age into account, and that kind of, I call it the contract between generations, where older people can help the younger and being inspired by the younger, the olders. And I totally agree with you. If you design for older people, it will benefit also the younger and the kids and the families. So that is really one of the big ambitions. And so the book gonna come out in about a half year. It's gonna be published by Penguin. And if you give me your email address, I send you a copy. More questions?
Да, Матиас, спасибо большое за лекцию. Такой вопрос у меня к вам. Вот вы сказали, что идея семейности, семейной жизни, она устарела. Соответственно, у меня возникает вопрос, какая идея должна прийти на смену вот этой старой идеи? Мы говорим о каком-то там коммунизме или вот что-то вроде этого. Спасибо.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the new idea, the old idea of family was that you're born, you get educated, you find a job. You get married, you have kids, you live together happy ever after. And it's not a reality anymore. In most societies, you have the divorces, people separate, they remarry or don't remarry, they live in different kind of configurations. Even that I'm not allowed to say it in Russia, but even men and men or women and women living together. There are all of these kind of different relationships now that are just reality of society, which are not being, which are not so dogmatic anymore. And with us now, we need to adjust that it's actually possible that these different configurations can live together. And for me, some of my best friends are actually considered family, and I could imagine that I live together with them at a later age. So we just have to be open now to rethink the way how society is and be realistic about the society and take that into account. More questions? Otherwise, I'm also here if you just have a direct and private question. There's more conversation possible today. And just one final comment, I must say that being invited here, the last time I was in Russia is 20 years ago, was an absolute honor, everything I have seen here, it's an amazing kind of reflection of the energy that's happening right now here in the city. And yeah, I want to thank you for the invitation and want to thank you all for coming. A real honor. Thanks.